thank you very much for the friendly invitation and introduction too. In 2008, the Deutsche Akademie der Naturforscher Leopoldina was named the German National Academy of Sciences. This decision came as quite a surprise to some, because the Leopoldina had played a special role within the German academic framework for centuries, operating from the institutional margins rather than at the center of scientific policy interests. To understand that Leopoldina's special role and its uniqueness in comparison to the other significant German science academies, it is necessary to look back at its founding. This long-term perspectivation is necessary because the Leopoldina's early modern roots and character have cultivated a formative power that shapes tradition and is hugely significant for the sense of identity. Even today, the Leopoldina proudly presents itself as the oldest continuously existing academy in the world. This attachment to history has at times been ambivalent and even hindered and impeded necessary reforms in the history of the Leopoldina. The Leopoldina was founded, Wolfgang Eckert has mentioned it, in the Franconian city of Schweinfurt in 1652 under the name of Academia Naturae Curiosorum. In the last quarter of the 17th century, the Academy was granted a number of privileges by Emperor Leopold I, hence the origin of the prefix in the name Leopoldina. As an Academy of Natural Sciences, it remained a learned society which focused on medicine and natural sciences until late in the 20th century. The Academy had a comparatively complex double structure of disciplinary divisions. Classes were only introduced in 2009 on the one hand, as well as geographical definite adjunct territories on the other hand. The Leopoldina functioned as an academy for correspondence, networks, and publications without a permanent location. During these nomadic years, the academy was always relocated to the place of resistance and work of the incumbent president. Not until the academy reforms in the last third of the 19th century did the academy eventually settle in Halle, a university town with a rich academic tradition. And this nomadic era in the history of the Leopoldina came to an end in 1878. Primarily, financial and infrastructural factors prompted this decision. This step finally created the necessary conditions which allowed something of an academy life to develop over the following decades and to go beyond the written exchange of publication, circulars, or correspondences, and sometimes encounters with the one or other member of the academy. By the way, various attempts to reform the academy were more oriented towards the French model of the academy, of the Académie des Sciences, or the British model of the Royal Society than the academy model established in Germany in the 19th century. I come to my second point. The Leopoldina still found itself in the margins of at the turning points of modern science around 19, which was characterized by rapid development, most notably in natural, technical, and medical sciences, as well as an institutional restructuring of the scientific landscape. The Leopoldina remained also in the margins when the science academies and societies in Berlin, Munich, Leipzig, Heidelberg, Göttingen, and Vienna formed first the cartel of German language academies, and then, together with a number of foreign academies, the International National Association of Academies, both without the Leopoldina. During the First World War, when international cooperation was abounded, so shortly after it had been enthusiastically embraced, the Leopoldina set itself more or less also apart from the others, or also from the opinions of the others and the activities of them. When the end of the Leopoldina loomed for financial reasons during the period of inflation in the start of the 1920s, it was only saved from the dissolution by the contesting intercession of the Prussian Academy of Sciences on account of its venerable traditions and extensive library collections. In the period thereafter, the Leopoldina tried to counteract its loss in importance by implementing a variety of changes. But however, the president of the Academy at this time, the geologist Johannes Walter, tentatively started to transform the Leopoldina into a working, lively academy, introducing, for example, regular academy meetings with scientific lectures. This at least led to the formation of a sort of Halle Corps of scholars who met on regular basis. But it was Walter's successor, the Swiss physical chemist Emil Abderhalden, who took office in 1932, who finally set about modernizing the academy with more vigor than his predecessors. During this tenure, which essentially covered the period of the Third Reich, the Leopoldina raised its own profile. Without relinquishing its tradition, he tried to channel the academy's development towards a modern science academy. For example, by streamlining the academy management, restructuring the sections and departments, establishing the first small academy ventures, or demonstrating caution's openness to the humanities. Another example are his policy of election. A number of more than 200 new members came into the academy in 1932, among them such famous and important scientists as Marie Curie or Albert Einstein. But even in the Third Reich, the Leopoldina remained an outsider among the science academies of the German Reich. In any case, the National Socialist interest in scientific policy concentrated on the university and non-university science and research institutions, which were considered relevant for arms and war. From a scientific policy perspective, the science academies at all were viewed as less important. However, they were not entirely neglected, seen, for example, as they were included in the expulsion of Jewish and political undesirable members, and attempts were made to entrench the Führer Prinzip in the science academies. This also applied to Leopoldina. Emil Abderhalden's revaluation campaign, so put it by Rüdiger von Bruch, and the efforts of cautiously modernize and stabilize the Leopoldina paved the way for a new start after 1945, but did nothing to change the fact that the Leopoldina retained its special status during the Cold War. While the other science academies in the Soviet occupation zone and later the GDR, the Saxon Academy of Sciences and Humanities, and most notably the former Prussian, then German, and finally the Academy of Sciences of the German Democratic Republic, were quickly adapted to suit the scientific and also economic structures of the second German state, the Leopoldina was excluded. Attempts to change its profile and position in line with GDR politics failed, not least due to its traditional character. In this respect, the Leopoldina proved remarkably resistant to all attempts at political interference. Also, the Leopoldina recurrently had to grapple with the permanently suspicious GDR authorities and was kept under extensive surveillance by the Ministry of State Security, the Staatssicherheit. It retained a relatively independent position in the academic life of the GDR. However, it also had to outwardly fulfill his function, first and foremost as a representative flagship. During the Cold War years, the Leopoldina saw itself as a firmly pan or all German academy with many members from West Germany, Austria, or Switzerland. In contrast, most notably to the Academy of Sciences of the German Democratic Republic in Berlin, which had by that time evolved into a socialist research academy, in line with the Soviet model and with great significance for GDR basic research and the national economy. The Leopoldina in Halle was largely spared disruption and upheaval after 1989. In fact, the years that followed saw the Leopoldina move from the scientific political periphery into the center. While the Academy in Berlin lost its research role in the national scientific, technical, and medical field following the collapse of the GDR, and was refounded in 1992 as the Berlin-Brandenburg Academy of Sciences and Humanities, a society of scholars with academic projects in the humanities. The very structure and identity, which had not infrequently proved a hindrance in the past, now worked at the Leopoldina's advantage. My fourth point. Having arrived at these findings after such a tour de force through the history of the Leopoldina, we could conclude that lecture at this point. But I don't want to close without a last briefly mentioning possible research perspectives and prospects. The Leopoldina is undoubtedly one of the well or best researched science academies in Germany and perhaps even further afield. I will not go in details because it would be not allowed by the time, but in a written version it will, I will do that. But why should there be any further need to continue researching academies or the history of the Leopoldina in the 20th century when so many research is already done? My reflections primarily follow two directions. First, on the temporal horizon. At first, an examination of the more recent research on the history of scientific institutions reveals that after years of intensive preoccupation with the period from 1933 to 1945, interest seems to be shifting towards the years after 1945. That is, in the consequence of National Socialism and the Second World War under the geopolitical global circumstances of Cold War. I have already said that there is more need, or there is a need for further research on the Leopoldina and other German academies. I'm thinking, for example, about the academy's way of dealing with the National Socialist past after 1945 in general, as well as that of some of its members. One question could be whether there was a downside to the academy's traditionalist, conservative, tendentially non- or anti-communist self-image, which has been so often emphasized. The Leopoldina membership certainly includes some whose activities in the Third Reich were not beyond reproach, and even some who were actively involved in the crimes of the NS regime. Was there, maybe, a kind of indulgence on the one hand side, but a much more strictness in relationships to what seems to be a political left scientists also included Jews or remigrants. Another aspect, more recent research on scientific institutions has also shown how fertile the ground for research is when one looks beyond watersheds moments such as 1940, the First World War or the years of the Third Reich, especially as they are so closely connected to the circumstances in Germany. In this vein, greater depth could be achieved in the analysis of factors rooted further in the past, which determined the path taken to the relationship between continuity and discontinuity, both with regard to the Leopoldina as well as the other German academies. In Germany, there is in German historiography, we have the term of Pfadabhängigkeit. It could be a keyword for further research in this case. My reflections go at least towards new methodological approaches. Due to the time constraints, I will just outline very few key points here. Important methodological inspiration for contemporary academy historiography could, in my opinion, give rise to these newer approaches which have taken the more recently university historiography or the extensive work on the history of non-university research institutions such as Kaiser Wilhelm Max Planck Gesellschaft or the German Research Foundation as a starting point. From a methodological perspective, they offer many productive stimuli for the continued development of academy historiography. Indeed, the Ressourcen füreinander, resources for each other approach developed several years ago by Mitchell Ash continues to provide inspiration, not least concerning the relationship between science and politics, but not only. I also find it unconscientious to say that in the future, academy historiography must be approached with greater international comparison, particularly with regard to the Cold War in a global dimension. Heidemarie Uhl and Johannes Feichtinger have already provided important impetus on this topic with their conference proceeding on the Central European Academies of Science in the Cold War. But in this context, even such apparently self-evident terms such as internationality of science and science institutions deserve closer attention as they are subjects to remarkable and transformations as shown in various works on institutions operating internationally, including outside academic institutions. For the Leopoldina, for example, it could be interesting to find out how the postulated internationality related to the accusation of provinciality to which the academy had long been exposed. Finally, networks, relationship frameworks, association or informal communication forms and channels need to be examined in greater detail. In addition, topics pertaining to praxeology and cultural history, such as the form and impact of performance, rhetoric or symbolic representation, and of course gender aspects, as well as other questions of exclusion and inclusion should be also considered. A lot of more questions remain open. And with a few side look on the time, I will come to an end and thank you very much for your attention.